Why is it so important to help our kids process their emotions? In this video, we will learn why helping your child process emotions can help them make good life choices and be far less likely to engage in self-destructive behavior such as drug abuse. To do that, we have to first talk about how your child's brain works. The human brain sometimes seems chaotic, like this intersection. Thoughts come and go seemingly at random. It's the same with feelings. Sometimes there are flashbacks to painful memories in the past. Sometimes people feel good about themselves, and other times feel terrible. It seems as if there is no method to the madness.
The brain is not chaotic. Instead, it's actually the most organized, sophisticated machine we have ever discovered. It's millions of times more advanced than our current technology. Only seems disorganized when we don't understand how it works.
We are going to show you how some brain structures can lead to self-destructive behavior. But first, we need to start by understanding how memories are made. This gray pipe is an illustration of a brain connection. Memories are stored as one or more of the brain connections. Let's start with the simplest of memories. For example, this might be a memory your child made when they noticed the bikes at school. Let's look at a different simple memory. In this case, your child tripped briefly on the sidewalk, but no one notices, and she quickly caught herself and kept walking. It was a little embarrassing, but she knows everyone has done it, so it's not a huge issue. Because she had an emotion associated with the memory is connected to the embarrassment structure of her brain. This will tell her what feeling to have when she remembers the memory.
If I think back to an embarrassing situation, I am embarrassed instantly and I never get confused and have another emotion like sadness or envy or happiness. I have the same emotion because that memory is connected to the part of my brain that feels that emotion.
Now let's show what happens if the situation is more extreme. In this example, another child at school criticizes your daughter in front of the whole class and she is highly embarrassed. Notice that instead of just one connection, she has a lot more, and each has another connection to the embarrassment structure. But it doesn't stop there. Because it was so embarrassing, she is likely to ruminate on it.
So rumination, it's really unfortunate because the more we do, the more these brain connections stack on top of each other and the harder it is for our brain to process.
She might wonder why the other child was mean or why the teacher didn't stand up for her. All the rumination creates lots of new connections, and each one is linked to the embarrassment structure. This is what happens when multiple, highly painful experiences start piling up. The brain starts to see a relation between them all and starts to build a new set of connections called a negative belief. As you can see, sometime in her past, she had hurtful memories of being called stupid, failing a test, struggling with math, and doing poorly at a spelling bee. All of these experiences helped her conclude that she isn't smart enough, which is a new physical structure in the brain that is connected to all those unprocessed hurtful experiences.
Painful memories don't have to grow and cause all this anguish. They can actually fade away if processed with another safe person. Processing emotions can be as simple as sharing the experience and feelings in a safe and peaceful environment. Research has shown that when processed with a safe person, the memory actually fades away.
Let's go up another level. Even though her core negative belief is, I'm not smart enough, she may never consciously think that specific thought. The belief will turn into other thoughts. In this case, she frequently thinks, I'm stupid, I'm terrible at taking tests, and I'm horrible at spelling. Let's go up to the top level. After having these thoughts, she will often have a behavior. The first type of behavior she may have are coping behaviors. We do these when we are stressed out, like eating junk food, surfing the internet, binge watching a TV show, or using drugs.
You might have heard someone say after a rough day, I need a drink. That is a coping behavior because they're trying to cope with a difficult day. Coping behavior is often our way of trying to numb the negative thoughts and beliefs about ourselves. This is why some people need to use drugs or alcohol daily while others don't. Coping behaviors are often self-destructive behaviors that can dramatically reduce our long-term well-being.
The second type of behavior happens when the bottom three layers trigger our primitive brain to take over. When that happens, we can do all sorts of behavior that we wouldn't normally do if our logical brain was still in charge. We often get angry almost instantly. We yell or we say things we might later regret. A lot of self-destructive behavior happens when the primitive brain takes over. Next, let's look at how these branches might get triggered. First, she has a trigger event when she hears about an upcoming spelling bee. Step one is that she might immediately flash back to a hurtful experience when she did poorly at a previous spelling bee. She instantly feels those negative emotions that are tied to that bundle of brain connections. Step two, because these are all connected in her brain, her thoughts travel up to the negative belief of not being smart enough. That then makes her feel those negative emotions. For step three, it travels up and she thinks one or more of her usual thoughts. And then finally, for step four, she has a behavior. In other videos, we will show you how to help them process their emotions.
The more unprocessed hurtful experiences your child has, the more likely they engage in self-destructive choices. On the other hand, if you make it a priority to help them process their emotions, you can dramatically increase the odds that they grow up to make wise choices.